Okay, so let's start. So the last thing we did is an example of a space which is connected but not path connected, right? And this is the ordered square. You said something. Let's talk after this, okay? This is one point which is not correct. I will give another example now, okay? More familiar. So this was the ordered square. The ordered square is connected but not path connected, okay? And here's another example, more familiar maybe with this example. Okay, so what? We take the graph of the function sinus 1 over x, okay? Starting at a certain point. So this is a graph, G graph. So what is it? It's x cross sinus 1 over x. X bigger than 0, obviously, and smaller than some constant, okay, which I don't care, some constant. So this is a graph of the function sinus 1 over x, no? That's what it is, the graph. It starts somewhere, that depends on the constant, and then it goes in this way, and now it comes oscillating, okay? Sinus 1 over x, it's in some sense you change the sides, no? There are all these which come here, come now in this part, okay? So this is a graph of this function. And g, obviously g is path connected, okay? This is an exercise. G is path connected. Why is g path connected? Well, it's a graph. You take two points and just follow the graph, right? You follow the graph, so it's path connected. That's no problem. So that means it's connected also, okay? Path connected is easy, no, in general, as I said. So it's also connected. G is connected. And now I take, so here maybe it's here and it starts somewhere. That doesn't matter, okay? On this side, it doesn't matter. The interesting thing. So then also G closure. So what is this? Now it takes a closure. So, sorry, this is a subspace of R2, okay? This is obviously, we are in R2, so this is the subspace of R2. That's our topology, clearly. So we are in R2. Standard analysis, R2, okay? So what is the closure of G? It's G. And then it's clear what you have to add is this interval, right? These are points in the closure. If you take a neighborhood here of any point here, then you always intersect this, no? It comes arbitrary close here, okay? So the closure of G is G union, what is this? This is 0 times minus 1, 1. Okay? This is this interval here. Right? That's the closure. Clearly. No other points in the closure. These points are in the closure. So this is also connected. It's connected. The closure of a connected set is connected. That's a general fact, okay? The closure of a connected set is connected again. So this is connected. And this is our example. This now does not look very path connected, okay? G is okay, but G bar is connected, but G bar is not path connected, okay? That's a fact. So it's connected, but G bar is not path connected. Intuitively, this might be quite clear, no? Because what you will don't see is a path which comes from this part to the other part, okay? There, in some sense, you have to jump. to go over? Well, I will prove. One has the proof. I will indicate the proof, okay, that it's not path connected now. But it's intuitively, it's strange to have a path from here, from this part to this part, no? That's the idea. So we prove there's no path which goes from here to here, okay? And then it's not path connected. That's the second example, more familiar, no? Because this is standard R2 graph of a standard function, sinus 1 of x, and so on and so on. So it's not path connected. So why not? So suppose we have a path which goes from this part to this part, okay? Suppose there is a path f from the interval to g bar such that, which goes from one part to the other, such that f of 0 is in this part, okay, 0 times minus 1, 1, and f of 1 is in the other part. This element, so this is the graph itself, okay? So we have suppose we have a path which goes from some point on this here to some point in this here, right? And I will prove that that is not possible, okay? Now we need a contradiction, okay? There's no path going from this to the other, from this part to this part. No, okay? That's what we want to prove. It's okay? So what? Let me give the idea now. We can assume. That f of t is in g for t bigger than 0, okay? So maybe we come here, then we come back, where we take the last point where we are here, and after this we are here. We take the sup, okay, that's the maximum where we are here of all points, and after this we are here. The path finishes in some point here. No, I don't know which one. And starts in some point here. So we take the last point where we are here. And then we are always here. Okay? Taking the sup, but which is the maximum. Okay? So that means we can assume that the path starts here somewhere. This is P, a point P. Okay? F for T bigger than. Only F of 0. That's. So f of 0, this is our point P. This, of course, is in the other part, okay? So this is 0 times minus 1, 1. And after this, we are on this side. That's no problem, okay? And now we want a contradiction. F of 0 is P. So this is f of 0. Now f is continuous in this point, 0. Okay, f is continuous. So that's f is continuous. In 0. Clearly, f is continuous in each point, okay? So we give a neighborhood u. What kind of neighborhood? So I give a neighborhood which is, I intersect with an open ball with a radius which is not too large, okay? So this one, okay? So this is the ball around P with some radius epsilon, which is small. And then we have u equal B P epsilon intersection with G bar. So what is this? How does it look like? This is this one, no? This part. And then we have all these pieces here, okay? Right? Infinitely many approaching this. They look, no, it's even here. It depends where this point is. They are not connected even here now, okay? If you take this point as P, then we have this. But in any case, whatever P is, it doesn't look connected, what we see here, okay? These are single pieces, right, of one or another form. Either intervals, here it's intervals even, okay? Or intervals of this type, which are connected, okay? So there's a neighborhood of zero, which we take an interval, okay? So then there is a neighborhood. So I take zero, we are in the closed interval here, no? Zero, epsilon kind of takes zero delta, open, okay? Here closed, because that's the first point. Of zero in the interval I, such that the image is in U, okay? Such that the image f of zero delta is contained in U by continuity. U is this, okay? The ball, okay. So that we get by continuity. But now we need a contradiction, okay? This is connected. That's the point. This is connected. These intervals are connected, okay? The image of a connected is connected. That remains connected. So this is connected. Okay. But the image here, so this has a point P, no? And then all the rest are on the other side here, okay? That's the last point. F of zero is P. That's this, okay? This would be the center of this. It doesn't look like this. No. This is this, and then after, if t is bigger than 0, we are on the other side, okay? So we are in U somewhere here, no? This is also our neighborhood, U. And then, but this is not connected, clearly, okay? This is not connected. This cannot be connected, okay? So, because you see that it's not. So there's some, you have some, this point and you have some other point here in the image, okay? But you can separate all this here somewhere, okay? But clearly, so that's the last, wherever I should write that. Clearly, f of, what is it? Zero epsilon delta. It's not connected in U, okay? It's not connected in U. And so we have a contradiction. So let's put it this. So it's not possible to go from a path from here to here. That's the point. That's the second example, okay? That's called, in some sense, this is called topology sine curve, okay? This, I don't know what exactly, but this is a well-known example in topology, also in analysis, I suppose. So this is a second example, okay, of a space which is connected, but not path connected. This is okay. Now, well. The point is that this is not locally connected in this point. So I give the definition of locally connected. We will not do much with this. So definition. A space X is locally connected locally connected in a point x and x if for every neighborhood u of x, there's a smaller neighborhood v, there is a neighborhood v of x, v of x contained in u, so a smaller neighborhood, which is connected. So for each neighborhood, you find a smaller neighborhood which is connected. That's locally connected, okay? And the example is, the problem in our example is that, so the example is this, no? Sine curve. And so on. Plus this here, no? That's this G bar. G bar is connected, no? That's is wrote, but not locally connected in certain points, obviously, no? In all these points, it's not locally connected, okay? But not locally connected. That's a point, but not locally, locally connected. In fact, in all points of this part, it's not locally connected, okay? It's not locally connected in all points of this part, which is 0 times minus 1, 1. If you take any point here, in fact, any point of this does not have a single neighborhood which is connected, OK? So it gets very wrong, OK? There's not even one neighborhood which is one neighborhood of this point. One small neighborhood, okay, I should say, okay? I mean, what is the neighborhood of this point? You can take everything, and this is connected, okay? But in fact, so if you take a small neighborhood here, it's never connected, okay? In fact, so this is what I wanted to write. What did I write? But not locally connected in all points of 0. Yeah, what? It's clear, okay? So this is an example of a space which is connected, but not locally connected, okay? And you see what goes wrong here, because this falls apart in many things, okay? You can separate something. This line, you say this is left, right, okay? And you separate this, okay? So this is locally connected, and this is a problem here. Then the last thing which I want to do for connected things is another definition. So you define also locally path connected, okay? But I will not write that. Locally path connected is the same. You say it's locally path connected in a point if for every neighborhood of x, there is a neighborhood v of x contained in u which is path connected. Okay, you just connect it replaced by path connected. That's locally path connected. And it's clear that locally connected implies path, sorry. Path connected implies connected, so locally path connected implies locally connected. Right? I will not write. So, again, so locally connected. And then the last definition, component. Connected component. So X is a space. Topological space, a component of X, sometimes a connected component, but component of X is a maximal connected subset. of X. So, and then we have also path component. A path component is a maximal path connected subset of X. Same definition. A path component of X is a maximal path connected subset of X. So this is a definition. Component, path component. And now, well, it's well defined, this definition. If so that requires a little proof, okay? If we have two components and they have a point in common, then they are equal. Okay? If two components so affect two components are either equal or disjoint. Because if you have two connected subsets and they have a point in common, then the union is connected. Okay? That's exactly this, right? If you have two components connected and they have a point in common, then the union is also connected. So two components are either equal or disjoint. Two path components are either equal or disjoint. Why that? Well, I make a picture here. So let's say we have here a path component, okay? This is path connected. And this is path connected. And they have a point in common. And then I say the union is also path connected. Same situation as here, okay? If there's a point in common, the union remains path connected. Why is that? So take any two points. If they are in one of these two, it's anyway path connected, no? This is path connected, this is path connected. So interesting case is where you take one here and one here. Okay? And we have to find a path. How do we do that? Well, we have a point in the intersection. That's okay, intersection is not empty. Now we can find the path here from this to this, because this part is path connected, okay? But we can also find a path from here to here. So another path, G, okay? And now we can easily construct this path, first F and then G, from this point to this point. That we will do anyway later, okay? But it's clear that we have a path. In the first half of the path, we take F, in the second half, G. And by the pasting lemma, it's continuous also. This product, it's called the product of passes, okay? The product of F and G. And so this means the same for path components. If they have a point in common, then they have to be equal. Okay? Because otherwise, it was not maximal, no? So we have components, path components. And now we give example. So we have here this example. No, this is G bar, which I call G bar. So connected means one component, of course, right? That's the same, no? Connected means one component. The whole is connected, okay? One component. So this is connected. One. How many path components here? Here? No. Path components. You cannot go from a point here to a point here, no? But G is path connected. Two, yes, two. So G bar G bar has two path components. visual G, no, the graph itself, and 0 times minus 1, 1. Right? Because this is path. Here you have no problem with the path, no? Here you have no problem with, you follow the graph. But you have a problem to go from one to the other. That's what we indicated, okay? So there are two path components. Now, take our other example. So, we ordered square. This is connected. So it's one component, okay? Connected is the same as one component, clear? Clearly, all right? It's not path connected. That's what we proved, okay? So now the question are, what are the path components of the ordered square? Yes, exactly. The path components are x times, so I should have written this maybe, x times the this is the ordered square, no? And these vertical lines, okay? So this is x times I, no? X and a, I. Obviously, this is an interval, right? So this is connected, path connected. The interval is path connected. But you cannot make it larger, path connected, because if you make it larger, then you have two points with different first coordinates. And there's no path, in also in the hole here, to a point. So the fact is, there are no, let me write here. If two points have different first coordinates, there's no path from one. If two points in I ordered square have different first coordinates, then there's no path between them. From one to the other, no? Why not? So why not? So that means this is maximal path connected, okay? We cannot enlarge. We cannot take this point, because then there's no path. So why? If you have different points here, why is there no path from here to here? Sorry? By the same proof. Yeah, we prove there's no point from here to here, no? But now we have these two points, it's the same proof. Okay, if there would be a path from here to here. Well, let me make a picture. No, I don't, yeah. So here's the same picture. So let's suppose we have a path from here to here, no? What I'm so this gives me an interval, right? These two points. Okay. If you have a path from here to here, by the intermediate value theorem, I get all points between, as before, okay? By intermediate value theorem, as yesterday, okay? I get all points between, because this is a value, this is a value, these are all points between these two, okay? I get everything, everything in this interval here, okay? So then the same argument applies. Now I take the pre-image of all these here, okay? This is open. Pre-image is open. We have uncountably many, so we get uncountably many rational numbers. So it's the same argument. If it's this, yesterday it was this and this point, okay? And now it's this and this point, and we have this interval from here to here only, okay? Yesterday we had this interval from here to here, which is everything, okay? But it's the same argument, exactly the same argument. So that proves that if it's path-connected something, this is path-connected, it's an interval, but it cannot be larger. So these are the path components. So this means there are uncountably many path components here, okay? It's a very strange example. Here we have two path components, no? Here in this example, there are uncountably many path components. It's connected, but uncountably many path components. So uncountably many. Okay. So these are some concepts, you know, locally connected, locally path connected, components, path components, which are sometimes useful, but we will not go into this. With this, I finish now the chapter on connected, and we have to go to the next one. It's sort of nice to play around with this, no? Another question, which I don't want to do now, is you take the ordered square and ask, so, in which points of the ordered square is locally path-connected? Locally path-connected, okay? Or path-connected? Anyway, it's connected. Or connected. It's connected anyway. Connected is not the problem, but because intervals are connected, okay? But path-connected, locally path-connected. What are the points in which it is locally? So you can give exactly, huh? I will not, maybe I give this as an exercise, okay? Then you can write. So what you say?
Those points, the second coordinate, is either 0 or 1.
Second coordinate, is, so we are here or here?
Yeah.
What are these points?
Yeah.
Where it's... Yeah, it's not locally in this point. Because if you take a neighborhood of this point, then you can, of course, you can go here on this side, okay? But on the other side, you have to go to this, and then you get all this stuff, and maybe the other side. This, okay? And then you get all this stuff, and then you finish somewhere here, no? So get all this stuff here. And again, this is not path connected, but always the same argument, okay? So it's clear, this, in this point, it's not locally path connected. In this point, the same argument, it's not locally path connected. Sorry?
Any other point?
Yeah, it seems. So that's already the answer then, yes. Well, let's... No.
But yeah. It's an exception.
Yeah. So here it is. So, and probably here, we have to check. So here you have this neighborhood, okay? So this is locally path connected. In this point, yes. In this point, yes. In this point,
no.
In this point, no. We have to go. So it's... all these points, with the exception of this and this. That's the final answer, okay? Yes. So this is was an exercise. I didn't want to do that, but no. He gave the answer, so... It's similar, the arguments, okay? All, yes. Okay. Now we have compact spaces. It's nice. We start from the beginning again, always, compact spaces. So you... So we need to introduce a language also here, okay? So the language is as follows. A covering, an open covering, we need what is an open covering of a space X. It's a collection of open subsets of X. Well, it's clear what it is. It's a collection. Collection, family, maybe not set, because it's a collection of open subsets of X whose union is X. So they cover X. Okay. So definition, that's a very short definition of compactness, the shortest possible. A space X is compact. The less technical also. A space X is compact. If every open covering of X contains a finite subcollection which covers, contains a finite subcollection so we will have examples then. This is words. It's compact if every open covering of X contains a finite subcollection which covers X. Finite subcollection which covers X. And I will use here, and this is not the book, but it's very convenient. I will say contains a finite subcovering. It's not clear what is the subcovering in general, okay? One has to define, okay? But I will say finite subcovering for this. You have a covering, okay? And finitely many of these, you don't change the sets, okay? And then you call it a subcovering, okay? So this is convenient. Which contains a finite subcovering. That's what I will use, a finite subcovering. Sometimes you make subcover, you change the sets, make them smaller or something. That may happen, but that we don't want here. So examples. But before examples, I have to prove I will prove a lemma, which is useful here. And it's very boring, but it's useful. Lemma. So this condition of compactness, you know probably now. It's not so typical from analysis. No, there are various others. I mean, somebody who wants to define compactness, no, would not come up with such a definition. No, he would say compact means in Rn it should mean bounded closed, maybe. Okay, Heine Borel. In or you say any infinite subset has a point of accumulation, a limit point, or any sequence has a convergent subsequence, or something like that, right? That seems to be more natural, but it's more technical. Each of these definitions is more technical and less general, okay? So finally, this was the right definition of compactness, except Hausdorff, okay? Maybe Hausdorff, maybe not Hausdorff, okay? That we will. Here we don't have Hausdorff, okay? Just this very short definition, okay? We come back to the other versions anyway, okay? So lemma. Let Y be a subspace of X. Y in X be a subspace? Then Y is compact. And I introduce a language here, no finite subcovering. I introduce also here a language. Then Y is compact if and only if every open covering of Y in X. What does it mean? So this is a language. Open covering of Y in X. Here it's not in something. It's just open covering. Okay. Now say in X. That means in X. And Y is contained in the union, not equal to. Y may not be open. Okay. By open sets, that is, by open sets in X, okay, whose union contains Y, not equal to Y, whose union contains Y. Because Y may not be open, okay, so it's not equal to the union of open sets in general, okay, so contains only. So that's open covering of Y in X, okay, that's the language, okay. It's compact if and ever contains a finite subcovering. By open sets, again, by open sets in X, okay? By so finitely many open sets in X again, whose union contains Y, okay? So this is the lemma. That means if you have a subspace of a larger space, no, we can either work with open sets in Y or with open sets in X, and it doesn't matter, okay? Sometimes it's convenient to use open sets in X, okay? So we don't have to, okay, this is very, the proof is very easy. I mean, you just pass from open sets in Y to open sets in X, or you pass from open sets to X and go back to open set. You want me to prove it or not? To get used to it? Should I write the proof? What? Yes?
Yes.
Yes. I always did that. But if you say that's boring, then I will not do it. Okay? So to get used to the language, okay? It's of course it's useful. So proof. So if and only if. If and only if. Why? So we have two directions, no? Y is compact. So let's start with this one. This means now Y is compact, okay? That's the hypothesis. Y is compact. And what we have to prove? Every open covering of Y in X. Okay, so let U equal, yeah, it's some language, no? U equal U alpha, alpha and J. Be an open covering of Y in X. What does it mean? That means that, so this is a written U, okay? And this is stamped you. As usual, no? Basis B, and then the element stem B. B, an open covering of Weinweig. This means these are open in X, okay? U alpha, open in X. And Y is contained in the union U alpha, alpha, and J. Not equal, only contained. Okay. And now it's clear, it's easy, of course. Then U prime. This means U prime. What do? You take U alpha, intersection Y, alpha and J. So this is open covering of Y in X, no? What is this now?
An open covering of Y in Y.
Yeah, that you didn't say. Open covering of Y. Yes, in Y, exactly. Open covering of Y. And that means in Y, if you don't say anything. This is an open covering of Y. So Y is compact, okay? This, of course, means there's a finite subcovering, okay? There's a finite subcovering. What is it? U alpha 1 intersection Y, U alpha n intersection Y. Of Y, no? What do we have to prove?
There is a finite subcover of this open covering one.
Of this first one, okay. Yeah, and of course then you have U alpha 1, U alpha, so this then implies that U alpha 1, U alpha n, it's a finite subcovering of Y of this first one, no, okay. Now we go back to the first one. It covers. So these are in U and cover Y, okay? And cover Y. So this is one direction. And the other direction is obviously similarly, no? Shall I write also the other? Yes? To get used?
Yes.
Yes. So the other one is this one, no? So what do we have now? Every open covering of Y in X contains a finite subcovering of Y in X. And we have to prove Y is compact. So what means Y is compact? Every open covering of Y has a finite subcovering. So let, well, U in the first case was different, no? So U prime, I start with U prime. Equal U alpha prime, alpha and J, be a finite cover, be an open covering of Y. That means U alpha prime is open in Y, okay? So U alpha prime is open in Y. But what means open in Y? That means U alpha prime is equal U alpha intersection Y, where U alpha is open in X now. That's the subspace topology, right? And then, of course, U, which is U alpha, alpha and J, right? This is an open covering of Y in X now. Open covering is an open covering of Y in X. Now we have to say in X, open covering of Y in X. Here's just open covering Y in X. So the hypothesis, so U has a finite sub covering, okay, by hypothesis. Every open covering of Y in X contains a finite subcovering, okay? So this implies U has a finite subcovering U alpha 1, U alpha n. And this, of course, now we go back. This, of course, implies that U alpha 1 prime, U alpha n prime, you intersect now, okay, with Y. So U alpha 1 prime, U alpha n prime is a finite subcovering of U prime, of the original, okay? It's a finite subcovering. Of the original U prime, this one, open covering. And this means this is Y is compact. So this implies Y is compact. Each open covering contains a finite subcovering, okay? So Y is compact. So that's a proof. And now we can do examples. We just have the choice now, okay? We want to work in open sets in the subspace or in the large space, okay? And very often in the large space is better. It's less technical sometimes, okay? So, okay, examples. So first two easy examples from analysis, okay? 1 over n, n in n. So this is a subspace of the reals. Okay? Is this compact or not?
Not compact.
Not compact. Why not? Well, but that's not our definition, no? So we have to we cannot use closed and bounded, okay? It's bounded but not closed. But that's not our definition. Then we have to prove that it's the same in R, no? It's not so clear. So we have to give our definition, okay? We have to use our definition. By the way, let me call this Y. So one question is, what space is Y? What kind of space? What is the topology of Y? Yeah. Y has a discrete topology. That's exactly the discrete topology. A discrete space is compact if and only if it's finite. No, finite. Finite. Points are open, finitely many points. A discrete space, so this is compact if and only if it is finite. Because you're the covering by 1 point sets, no? And you cannot forget anything, okay? So it must be finite, otherwise. So it's not compact, okay? So then we know y equals 0 union 1 over n, n and n. So in general, proving non-compact is easy again, no? And not useful, maybe. Because you just need one open covering which does not have a finite subcover, okay? You have to find just one which does not have a finite subcover. Proving that something is compact may be more difficult, but this is useful, okay? Because you have to prove that every open covering has a finite subcover, no? This is other, okay? It's like connected, no? Connected, one has a proof, not connected. Just one example of a separation, okay? Here, just one example of a covering which has no finite subcover. So this one, now you say it's closed and bounded, but that we cannot use in this moment.
Okay, also, it's a limit union, it's a sequence union, it's limit, so it's compact.
Yeah, well, that's the same. Why?
There is a theorem, of course.
A theorem?
Yeah.
No. So it's compact. Yeah, that's a nice, that's the same. You say you have a sequence and its limit point. That's compact always.
Compact.
Yeah, that's okay. So let's prove it more general, okay? So this is compact. So xn converges to x, okay, in the space x, and in x. And then I take y equal x union xn, n in n. This is compact. This is a special case, no? But we have to use our definition, okay? So what is our definition? Every open covering has a finite subcovering. So we start with an open covering. So let u equal whatever, u alpha. I always write alpha in j, okay? Be an open covering. Of y. What is y? This is y. In x, I prefer to work with open sets in the whole space, okay? Open covering of y in x. So we have the point x, no? The limit point. That's a crucial point, obviously, no? Isn't one of these, no? Let x be in u alpha 0 in j. It covers everything, so x is somewhere. So this is the neighborhood of x, no? So xn converges to x, what does it mean? So xn converges to x implies they exist n in n, no? Such that xn is in, well, u alpha 0 for n bigger or equal, for n bigger than n or bigger equal, I don't know, whatever, okay? For n bigger than n, right? So that means in u alpha 0, we have almost everything already, okay? We have all points xn here, okay? So missing finitely many. So let xn be in u alpha n for, and now I choose the missing for n. For n. For n from 1 to n. These are the missing points, the first n points in the sequence, okay? These are missing still. And this implies that then u alpha 0, u alpha 1, u alpha n is the finite subcovering. So it's compact. it's always the same proof. No, you have to prove compact here, and you start with an open covering. Okay, and then you almost well, we will see other example. What now? This is an analysis. Now, I like to give another example, which is strange, maybe. But the proof is similar to this. So, example. Let X be a set with a finite complement topology. So we take a set and we take a finite complement. You recall that, okay? That's one of our examples also. So what are open sets? Open sets are those sets which have finite complements and the empty set. Yeah, and X, of course. But X has finite complement, no? Because the complement is empty, yes. With a finite complement. Then any subset of X is compact. Any subset Y of X is compact. What are the closed subsets? Huh? Finite sets, no? The finite sets. The closed subsets of X are the finite subsets. Not only, and X itself. That's maybe not finite. So here's a big difference between, with our definition, between compact and closed, okay? If X is infinite, there are many, everything is compact, but the closed subsets are only the finite subsets, okay? So you say something is wrong with the definition, maybe, no? So this means the compact subset has, is not closed with the definition, okay? Then we need Hausdorff, okay? If we add Hausdorff, so we will see in a moment, okay? Then you have to add Hausdorff. So sometimes in some books, compact means our condition plus Hausdorff, okay? To avoid this strange phenomenon, okay? So any subset y of x is compact, proof. And you see, it is a similar proof as this, okay? So let u be an open covering of, and so on. Let u, well, it's always u alpha in J, be an open covering of y, and I always prefer an x. That's why I proved the lemma first, okay? Go to x, open covering of y and x. And we have to prove there is a finite subcovering, okay? Always the same. So y is not empty. We can assume y not empty. If it's empty, well, what the empty set is compact, no? Because you don't need any covering as empty, subcovering, okay? We can assume y is not, so you choose one point. Let y zero be in y, fixed. It's not empty, we can assume, so take a fixed point. So y zero is in one of these, okay? Let y zero be in u alpha zero. It's a covering, so it must be in some of these, okay? But the complement of u alpha zero is finite. But x minus u alpha 0 is finite. And that means I'm not only interested in the point in y now, okay? So y intersection x minus alpha, u alpha 0, okay? It's finite also, of course. So there are finitely many points also. So that's finitely many, y1, yn. Right? Finitely many. And now the same as before. No, it's structure is the same as before. Let how did I write before? X n I didn't use here, xn, so let yn u alpha n for n between 1 and capital N. These are the missing points, right? Everything else is, and this implies then that u alpha 0, which contains almost everything already, okay? And then I add these, u alpha 1, u alpha n is a finite subcover, finite subcovering. And so it's compact. This is a strange example, but it's the same, sort of the same proof as this one, okay? We concentrate on this one point, and then we have a neighborhood which contains almost everything, and then we have finitely many missing, and we take finitely many. So in this case, the same proof, okay? So this means, observation, attention, so observation. This shows that a compact subset y of x need not be closed, okay? It's in general, it's not clear. This is an example, okay? Need not be closed. In general, okay? A compact subset means we have a subset and we take a subspace, okay? The subspace topology, and this need not be a closed, okay? So here's the example. Here we have the compact, everything is compact, okay? But the closed are very restricted, only the finite subsets. So there's a big difference between closed and compact here, okay?
This space is not
which one? Well, no. Let's forget metrizable in this moment. Why metrizable? Yeah, it's not metrizable. Why is it not metrizable?
Because if we have a space which is metrizable, the compact space is closed.
Say again?
If we have a metrizable space, the compact is closed.
Yeah, that's true, yes. However, metrizable is not the good word here. There's another word which we used already, which I used already. Yeah, Hausdorff. So, that is the next one. So, there's a proposition. First, the other direction. Okay. So proposition. A closed subset of a compact space is compact. This is no problem. A closed subset of a compact space is compact. If you have something compact and something closed in compact, then it's also compact. So proof. Can think of the proof. This is very easy. So proof. So what we have? A closed subset of a compact space. So why let y be a closed subspace? So this means this is compact and this is closed. That's our situation, okay? And we have to prove that y is compact, right? So let, always the same, without thinking. Let u be an open covering of y in x. Let u be an open covering. I don't even need names, as it seems. Be an open covering of y in x. I always prefer to work in the large space. Then, well, u, we get y. We want to get all of x now. So what is missing? X minus union x minus y. And what is this? This is open, no? Y is closed. So this is open. Is what an open covering of x? Now we get everything. It's an open covering of x. Okay. X is compact. So this means we have a finite subcovering, okay? There's a finite subcovering. U1, UN, this maybe I need, maybe I don't need, okay? But I can add it anyway, okay? X minus Y. So these are in U, and X minus, what is it, Y. I can add anyway, okay, in any case. Maybe this is sufficient, because we have an open covering of Y in X, might be already sufficient. So these are in U. Okay? And we want Y, so we just take only this now, and that's it. Okay? So this implies that U1, UN is an open, is a subcovering. Of what? Of U. Of y, of u of y, okay, that's not so. So that's the whole proof, okay? So this is trivial proof, no? You have a closed subset of a compact, you have an open covering, you just add x minus y, and then you have an open covering of the whole, and then you have a finite subcovering of both, okay? So this is very easy. The next one is this point. So it says that every compact subset is closed. It's not true. Of a Hausdorff space is closed. Okay? So, proposition. Every compact subset of a Hausdorff space. Is closed. So proof. So let fixed notation, let y as before, let y be subset. So this is what we have, compact, y is compact, and x is Hausdorff, okay? So this is our situation, x is Hausdorff. Without Hausdorff it's not true, no? We know already examples. We prove that, what is it? X minus y is open, okay? That's the idea, we prove that. We have to prove that y is closed. So we prove x minus y is open. X minus y is open. That's what we want to prove. Okay. So open means given a point, we should find a neighborhood which contains of the point which is contained here. So let x0 be a point. In x minus y. That's a complement, right? I write in this way the complement, x minus y. So let x0 be in x minus y. So maybe I make a picture here. So this is x, this is y, and now we have a point in the complement x0. Okay? And now for each point y, small y, in y, okay? So we have two different points here. It's Hausdorff. So we have disjoint neighborhoods, okay? Choose disjoint neighborhoods. Neighborhoods. That's neighborhoods. Somewhat shorter. This is fixed, no? This is a fixed point for the moment, okay? It's fixed. Y is not fixed. So it depends on y here. Neighborhood, so it's the index is y. Uy of x0 and vy of y. So here we have this neighborhood. This is u, y, and this is v, y. These are neighbors, okay? Of these two points, this point and this point. Then, so this we can do for any y, okay? So what you see immediately, if you vary y in y, okay, and you take all these vy's, what you see is an open covering of y in x, okay? So then all these v's, vy, y in y, take all, is an open covering of (clears throat) of y in x by open sets in x again. But y is compact, okay? So that means finitely many of these suffice, okay? Y is contained in finitely many. Y is contained in finitely many of these. Vy1 union Vyn. So finitely many suffice. To cover Y. That's a finite subcovering, okay? Finite subcovering. What do you want to prove? What do we want to prove? We want to prove that we find a neighborhood here which is contained here. What is the neighborhood? The intersection of the other ones now, okay? So let U be intersection UY1 intersection U, Y, N. And important is we have finitely many only now, okay? If we would do it immediately, then the intersection of open sets is not open in general, okay? But this is a neighborhood. We have only finite, we have a finite intersection of open sets, no? And this is open. So it's a neighborhood of, what is this point? X0 is the neighborhood of X0 contained in?
It doesn't intersect any of V Ys.
Yes, contained in. X minus Y. And this implies that x minus y is open, okay? So why is it contained in x minus y? No, no, one second. Y is contained here, no? Take a point. One second. So why is contained here? So if there would be a point here in this finite intersection, which was contained in Y, okay? There's no point in Y, that's what we want to prove, okay? In U, intersection Y is empty, that's what we prove. That's what we want to prove. U intersection Y is empty, okay? So it's in X minus Y. Suppose it would be not empty, okay? That means here's a point here which is in Y, okay? But the point here is in all of these. Because it's intersection. If you take a point here, it's in all of these, okay? A point here is in one of these, okay? Maybe the first one. But here it's in all this point, okay? So that means some intersection here is not empty. You want me to write that? Yes.
Contradiction.
Yeah, contradiction, right. Should I write? Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Well, maybe no. Yes. 4 minutes, that's... That's not okay, the clock, okay, it's open. So suppose U intersection Y is not empty. Okay, that's a contradiction, no? So let x be in, what x we don't have, no? No, x is a good name. X be in u intersection y. So x is in y in particular, no? That means x is in y, right? That means it's in one of these. So x is in u v y I for some I between 1 and n. It's in some of these because it's in here, okay? But x is in u. This implies x is in all of these, okay? So in particular, it's in u, y, I also, okay? U, y, I. And this implies that v, y, I, intersection u, y, I, is not empty. And that's a contradiction, no? Okay, because at the beginning, we have, where is it? Disappeared. Here, u, y of, disjoint. Okay, disjoint neighborhoods. So that's the clear then. Okay.